and it's getting worse. The number of opioid-related deaths is expected to rise by 147% from 2015 to 2025, prompting the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention to declare opioid abuse a public health emergency. And I'm going to be talking about one particular therapy, but I want to be clear that this is not a magic bullet. Addiction is a comprehensive problem affecting behavior, physiology, and cognition, so no single approach is going to tackle all three. A typical addiction treatment program includes medication-assisted treatment, like in the form of methadone to reduce withdrawal symptoms, as well as cognitive behavioral therapy, and you need strong social support. Also, every addiction treatment is different. Heroin withdrawal is very different from quitting smoking. So I'm going to talk about one therapy that benefits, I think, uniquely from virtual and augmented reality, and one that gets at, I think, the most basic foundation of addiction, and this is exposure therapy. Now, exposure therapy is where you create a safe environment in which to expose individuals to things that cause them anxiety. It was originally developed to help people deal with phobias, and it's the most effective treatment for anxiety disorders. It's also widely used for PTSD, obsessive-compulsive disorder, and different anxiety disorders. So typically you do this in vivo or in real life, where you have someone directly face a feared object, situation, or activity in real life. You typically do this in graded exposure. You start small, like a little spider that they just look at, and you graduate to bigger, scarier situations. This has the advantage of having perfect fidelity. You can't get much more realistic than real life. But it's also impractical, and it can be expensive. If someone's afraid of flying, you can't put them on a plane multiple times a week. So you also have imaginal exposure, which is just what it sounds like. You close your eyes, and you picture the thing that scares you. This has the benefit of being free and easy. But it also has really low fidelity, and not everyone's that good at convincing imaginations. And lastly, you have virtual exposure, where you show someone a virtual representation of a thing. This can be a picture, or it can be an immersive VR environment. This helps because it can be incredibly flexible. You can show people multiple situations you couldn't show them in real life. But it suffers from low fidelity, and it can also be expensive. So these last two problems are ones that are getting better with time. Now, therapists also report a bunch of big advantages for virtual exposure. You're having full control over the situations in a way you don't with like a real spider. And also being able to repeat specific exposure tasks, as well as expose people to situations and places that otherwise would be difficult. So here's an example of a VR therapy for fear of heights. And this is you would build up to this over the course of several weeks and months, but this is to give you an idea of the sort of stimuli I'm talking about. Here's another one that anyone can download, actually, for fear of spiders.
Right hand, so go, guys, go ahead. Okay, so my heart is pounding, and he's moving.
So that's level one. This is level five, which he just which he just flat out refused to try. So there's a wealth of research showing that this works. In a meta-analysis, concluded that findings demonstrate that virtual reality exposure therapy can produce significant behavior change in real-life situations. And it's worth noting that the research in these sorts of papers was done with really janky VR headsets from back in the day. I acknowledge I'm a huge VR snob, but I think there's certain requirements for achieving true presence in VR, with things like position tracking and certain levels of refresh rates and resolution and field of view. We have every reason to believe these effects would only get stronger and better with better headsets with room scale tracking. So exposure works for a couple different reasons. First, self-efficacy. It teaches people that they can actually confront these situations and nothing catastrophic will happen. It also helps with emotional processing, giving people techniques or ways of thinking to help them deal with these situations in real life. There's also two more, much more foundational sort of behavioral learning ways in which this works. And the first is habituation, which is a fancy way of saying we can get used to anything. So typically, if you confront something that makes you anxious or scared, your anxiety will increase, and then it will gradually taper off over time. And when you do this, when you confront the same thing again, the amount of anxiety you experience will go down every time. This is basically universally true. The final way it works is with extinction. And this is the real key of exposure therapy, because what we want to do is extinguish certain behaviors. Now, extinguishing behaviors can sound really sinister, but it's what you want when the behavior is maladaptive. So if you have social anxiety and you're afraid of going to a party, you just won't. And this is the kind of thing we want to get rid of. So this is the typical time course of anxiety, but if someone experiences something with a phobia, what they will do is they'll show what's called avoidance behavior, which is they just won't do the thing. If they think there might be a spider outside, they just won't go outside. And it works. You know, if something was making you anxious and it's no longer making you anxious, why wouldn't you do that thing again? This is a problem because while it might work in the short term, over long term it can make the fear become even worse. And it's a shame because our brains are hardwired to make this an effective strategy that we want to pursue. Everybody wants to pursue happiness and avoid discomfort, so why wouldn't you do this? So this is where addiction comes in. Because it worked, the same therapies that work to make you less afraid of spiders also help prevent you from relapsing. So relapse can work in very much the same way as avoidance behavior in phobia. So if someone is around a cue that makes them anxious and takes an action to make them less anxious, the same thing applies if they see a drug cue and relapse. Now, exposure therapy has been used for addiction for years. Back in the day, they would bring in recovering alcoholics and have them hold, smell, and even taste a little bit of a glass of beer. We know now this is not the right way to do it, but it's a technique we've been using for a long time. Unfortunately, it has a bad track record for opioid addiction. This is the last clinical trial that used exposure therapy for opioid addiction. They had 127 Dutch patients do 9 one-hour sessions, either with typical psychotherapy or with exposure therapy, in which they showed them videos of other drug users, and they had them handle drug paraphernalia like tinfoil and needles, even had them mimic the drug use ritual. Now, both groups showed lower subjective craving ratings after doing this sort of therapy, but they also measured skin conductance, so the galvanic skin response. So when you're in the presence of something that makes you anxious, your skin conductance will show it. This is how lie detectors work. And the control therapy group showed a decrease in skin conductance with cue in response to a drug cue. But the cue exposure group actually showed a much bigger reduction, showing not only that cue exposure therapy works, but that it works better than the typical way of doing things, the control therapy. So this is great, but there's a major caveat to the study, which is that it also made people drop out and relapse more. These are dropout relapse rates at 3 months after the study ended. The black bars are cue exposure therapy, and the white bars are placebo psychotherapy. So you really just can't have a therapy that leads to 40% of people relapsing after 3 months. People were understandably spooked by this study, and that's why there's been basically a moratorium on exposure therapy since this came out. But I think we should be looking at it again now that we have these new technologies, ones that address a lot of the limitations of these previous approaches. So the goal of cue exposure therapy is to extinguish the positive association between drug cues and their immediate positive effects. But the problem is that these extinguished responses, they frequently return when the same cues are presented in a different context. So consider a heroin addict who shoots up at home, context A, and then receives cue exposure treatment in a hospital room, context B. Following treatment, the addict returns home, context A, and then relapses. Doesn't this make perfect sense? If someone spends years doing drugs in their living room, that environment becomes rich with contextual cues. And then if you bring them to a totally sterile clinic where they've never been before and they have no association with, and you have them learn techniques for managing cravings, and then send them home to their drug cue-filled environment, obviously they're going to be likely to relapse. This also helps explain why relapse rates are so high when people leave rehab, why 6 months after leaving rehab, only 15% of heroin users are still abstinent. Now, what's frustrating about this is that none of it is surprising. This all makes perfect sense and is totally consistent with decades of research. We know that this happens since Pavlov studied it with his dogs. And then we had Skinner and his rats, you know, studying operant conditioning, giving them things they wanted when they pressed a lever, which is a pretty good analog to drug use. Then we started recording and stimulating rat brains, and we understood this at an even deeper level. We knew exactly what parts of the brain were involved in different types of learning, down to the firing pattern of individual neurons in those regions during learning. Heck, we even made a machine just to make slicing rat brains easier. We've studied them so much. So we've used everything from cocaine to food to shocks, slicing their brains before, during, and after learning. This type of learning is one of the best understood phenomena in science, from a behavioral to a neural level. Unfortunately, we put very little of what we've learned to use in how we actually do exposure therapy today. We have decades of studying the behavioral and neural basis of every part of addiction in perfectly controlled conditions. We know how exposure therapy should be done. Unfortunately, that's not how we're doing it. So to summarize, whereas conditioning generalizes readily, extinction is largely context dependent. So we know that exposure therapy should be done both in the original context, the place where you learn the association, and also multiple other neutral contexts. Instead, how we do it is in, oh wait, so you should do it in your living room where you did all those drugs all those years. But you should also do it in a bunch of other neutral contexts, places where you've never done the drug before. This will prepare you to go into other neutral contexts. And so we know this is how we should do exposure therapy. Unfortunately, how we do it is in a single neutral context, a totally sterile clinic environment. We know that we should be doing exposure therapy with short, frequent sessions. Instead, we do it with long sessions, days or weeks apart. Now, there are practical reasons for this. You can't have someone driving to the clinic multiple times a day, but we know that's how it should be done. That's how it would work best. We also know we should be using varied stimuli, but instead we end up using repeated stimuli. Now, if only there were some device that people could use in different environments to get different visual stimuli. So this is where mobile AR comes in. I think with mobile augmented reality, we could present cue exposure therapy in a much more effective way. People could be in their original environment, and they could see natural 3D representations of drug cues. This would work not only for opioid addiction, but it could work for cigarette addiction. It could work for alcohol addiction as well. Administering exposure therapy like this basically checks all of the boxes for how exposure therapy should be done. We can do it in multiple contexts. We can do it with short, frequent sessions. We can do it with varied stimuli. Unfortunately, there's still limitations to this approach. The main one being you have to actually be physically present in that environment. And for obvious reasons, we don't want to be sending alcoholics to bars to do therapy. So this is where VR comes in. VR lets you safely explore different environments that would be impractical or dangerous for you to go to in real life. So while this is being explored for addiction, it's really hard to get experimental footage. This is the closest I can get.
I'm gonna get a drink. You want to get a drink? Yeah, right? And drink a little of this,
So this is not how it would look exactly, but you get the idea. You could, with VR, you could put someone in a virtual bar environment, which you could use to elicit anxiety, and even have them practice interactions they would do in that situation, like ordering a non-alcoholic drink. Now, VR and AR both have their advantages, and I think they nicely complement each other. So if you think of a graph with environmental realism on the y-axis and stimulus realism on the x, exposure therapy has this sort of gradation where anything in the bottom left is bad, low realism, and the top right, high realism, is good. That's what you want. So traditional exposure therapy lives in this bottom little bar, where you can use really real stimuli, like actual drug paraphernalia, but you're stuck in this neutral, sterile clinic environment. Now, mobile AR, it just jumps to the top of this graph, where we can have perfectly natural, realistic environments. People can do this in their homes, in the park, in bars, anywhere. And the stimuli will be somewhat real, much more real than pictures, but still non-interactable. And so VR addresses those weaknesses by reducing the environmental realism. We're in these 3D generated environments, not a real room, but it can present a lot more different stimuli and let you actually interact with them. Now, it's also worth noting that while traditional acute exposure therapy is pretty fixed right there, both mobile AR and VR have nowhere to go but up and to the right here. As the technology improves, the level of realism will improve as well. Sure, you can't pick up a cold beer in VR yet, but we're working on exactly that technology. For temperature, haptic, even force feedback. So grabbing a cold bottle of beer in VR might not be that far off. And while you can't smell beer in VR, people are working on that too, with smell generator headsets that make you look like Darth Vader for some reason. And while right now we're using these 3D modeled environments that don't have the highest level of realism, mobile photogrammetry is only getting more effective. And we're not far off from letting people use their phones to capture an environment and then just making that scan easily accessible for someone to use. So I believe immersive tech helps with the more contextual side of addiction, which is arguably the more important part, recreating objects, places, or situations that it would be impractical or dangerous to do in real life. So while you don't want to tell a recovering alcoholic to go to a bar and give not drinking a shot, you want to send him to hundreds of different virtual bars to prepare him the next time he's in a bar he's never been in before. Now there's one other missing piece of this puzzle, which is physiological signal. So the goal of exposure therapy is to induce a tolerable amount of anxiety and then let someone ride it out to see that it's not that bad. You don't want someone freaking out. That defeats the whole purpose. That like just reassures that it's actually as bad as they were worried it would be. We also don't want them just like chilling like nothing is wrong. And so typically the way you do exposure therapy is in the presence of a clinician who's actively monitoring anxiety and arousal. Like when you do exposure therapy for PTSD, you have a doctor there who's looking at sensor data and then deciding when to set up virtual IED, when the arousal level is right. So typically you'll do this with dedicated sensors, like ECG or a breathing or a heart rate monitor. Mobile AR gives us this brand new capability where, because of the form factor of mobile AR, when you hold the phone, you just happen to frame your face perfectly with the front-facing camera, from which you can extract everything from heart rate variability, to breathing rate, eye movement, and even pupil size. These are all studies using either a webcam or a front-facing mobile camera. You'll notice they're all pretty recent, too. This is a very new capability that's only become possible now. And so the idea is, with this sort of capability, you could do exposure therapy, and you could not only control, but personalize the treatment. Everyone has a different drug history, and different cues will be more or less anxiety provoking. So with this sort of closed loop system, you could learn how different cues affect different people in different environments. So if you show someone all these different cues, and they start freaking out, you can start removing cues and to figure out what is the proper level of arousal and which cues are most effective. Now, VR also lets us get at physiological arousal, but in a very different way. As eye tracking becomes more and more commonplace in VR headsets, which I think it will, I think the next generation of VR headsets, eye tracking is standard from here on out. It's pretty easy to measure arousal from the eye, from pupil dilation or even patterns of eye movements. And I think it's only a matter of time until we start embedding sensors in the actual faceplate. I think every square inch of the faceplate that's touching you and not measuring something is wasted real estate. So I'll finish with what I think a day in the life of an addict in the future could be like. We'll call this hypothetical person Jack. So he wakes up in the morning, he heads off to work, and his GPS navigates him around a particular sketchy neighborhood where he used to score. And he shows up at the office and then has a meeting where he decides to engage his exposure therapy program and starts seeing drug cues on the table. Because at this point, we're out of the Google Glass, we're out of the glass hole phase, and we're in the totally inconspicuous mobile AR glasses phase. And so over the course of the meeting, his glasses detect that his arousal level is a little bit too high for the situation, so they change the stimuli to something a little bit less intense, and then gradually to something even less. So he finishes his workday, and then he gets a notification on his phone offering him bonus points in his exposure treatment program if he goes to a new place where he's never been before to do an exposure session. And it even guides him to a nearby park, where he goes and plays a specialized version of Pokemon Go that happens to include drug cues. So doing exposure therapy in this new environment helps him with dealing with cravings when he's in other new environments. Now, I don't have any research to back it up, but I think that using drug cues in game-like settings would actually be a really effective way of doing it. A lot of exposure therapy, it's not about sort of undoing the connection between drugs and feeling good, it's about making new connections. So seeing a drug cue and how it be associated with something other than doing that drug. And so I think games would actually be a really effective way to do that. So then he goes home and spends some time doing things that are not virtual or augmented reality. And he's been invited to a bar to celebrate a friend's birthday. Jack is also, unfortunately, a recovering alcoholic. It sucks to be Jack. So he grabs an empty bottle that he's been using for this sort of therapy, which, with mobile AR, he's able to perceive as a full bottle of beer. And he uses that same tracked bottle in VR, where he downloads a 3D scan of the bar he's going to. I don't think we're that far off from this. Like, bars even currently have 360 photos. I think it's only a matter of time until we get scanned as well. And he's got a supportive friend of his who offers to meet him in that virtual bar to help him acclimatize himself to it. And they both already, 3D photogrammetry scanned their faces so they can have some natural interactions in this bar. So finally, after enough practice, Jack feels comfortable going to this bar where he's able to have trendy stock photo fun with his friends in a comfortably familiar environment. So I'm painting this picture of this extreme version of the future, but I hope what I'm trying to get across is the unique affordances of this technology that's starting to come out. With addiction, things have gotten so bad, we can't afford to let a potentially useful, groundbreaking therapy that really does get at the heart of addiction go unused. I think that with this technology, the exposure therapy, which has gotten sort of a bad rep, all of a sudden has this new applicability. This is a therapy that millions of people could reach into their pockets and access for free right now. More than 750 million people have access to mobile AR-ready phones, and fewer than a third have even tried it. All right, I want to finish with the quote, good design is good business. It doesn't matter if it's game design or experimental design, whatever you're doing, just do good.